folks, this is Pastor Mike Hoggard coming to you from our top secret broadcasting studio here with another Watchmen video broadcast. We're talking about the singularity. I want to read to you what Ray Kurzweil said to kind of refresh your memory, kind of let you know where we're going today. Ray Kurzweil was asked about, did he think God existed? What he said was, does God exist? Well, I would say, not yet. What was he talking about? He was talking about the future of technology in this world advancing to such a state that it would bring about what he called the singularity. We talked about that last week and what it all meant. We're going to talk about some more things, but there's two ideas behind this singularity, two main thrusts, as it were, of where this road is taking us as a planet, as a species. And what bearing does it play in the scriptures? Let me read Ezekiel 28, verse 1. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus. We are dealing with principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in high places. This is what we're dealing with. We're dealing with the prince of Tyrus. And I want you to hear later on in Ezekiel 28, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. That was Lucifer, and it describes him as the anointed cherub that covereth. But listen what it says here. Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, and because thou hast said, I am a God. In your King James Bible, that's a capital G. Not just any God, that one. I'm a God, I sit in the seat of God, capital G, in the midst of the seas. What is that? The Bible talks about how God's throne is in the midst of a sea of glass, clear as crystal. Remember, the human heart is the same way. It has four chambers, which are the four living creatures, and it sits inside a sac called the pericardium that's full of seawater, salt water. It's what it is. There's the throne. Here is the throne of God in the midst of the seas. This is where he wants to sit. Do you remember going back all the way to the 70s, back when Star Wars first came out, there was a, I always saw it as a sort of a spin-off of Star Wars, even though it wasn't, Battlestar Galactica. I'm talking about the 70s version. The later version, I don't remember what was in the 2004, somewhere around in there. I watched every episode of that one too. But in the old version of the Battlestar Galactica, remember the Cylons, they were the humanoid robots who were the enemies of the 12 tribes of the humans trying to find a planet to live on. It's like Mormon doctrine all over again. But they had a chief, very intelligent robot that ruled over them named Lucifer. I don't know if you remember that or not, but it was a very highly intelligent computer robot named Lucifer, and he ruled over all the Cylons and so on and so on. He wanted to be God. I'm not saying the devil's a robot. What I'm saying is the two parts to the singularity are this. Number one, the evolution of machine to a state of self-awareness, giving it life. Number two, the fusion of machine with man to further his own evolution. What we're going to look at this week is the evolution of machine, how machines have progressed over the years. When I say machines, I'm talking about computers, robots, technology, artificial intelligence, things like that. The evolution of machine to a state of self-awareness. And I want you to understand what this takes. Self-awareness is I can close my eyes and I can visualize me from the other side of the room. I can visualize me looking at me, making these hand gestures at this desk. I can do that. I am self-aware. I am aware of my presence here in the universe, finding out what my purpose in life is. I'm aware of that. I am conscious of my reality. I am conscious of the fact that I believe the Word of God. That is being a self, that is being given life. If you remember, back in Genesis, God took the thing that he created, man. And what he did with man, he didn't do with any of the other creation. He blew into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. He became self-aware, intelligent, and being given the ability to stand upright. The animal kingdom does not have that. And so here we are trying to make a computer, an artificial intelligence system of some kind, that has the ability to perceive of itself, that it is conscious of itself, and thus probably being protective. I can turn my iPad off, I can turn my cell phone off, I can turn my computers off at will. Why? Because they're not sitting there going, I hope he doesn't turn me off. I'd like to keep going. They don't do that. They don't think that way. Yet. So what does this have to do with Bible prophecy? Is there anything in the Bible related to this? I think so. We talked about this last week, but let me read these verses again to kind of give you perspective of what the role of the false prophet is. Remember, in Revelation 13, we have the beast rising up out of the sea, out of the heart of man, and then we have the false prophet rising up out of the earth. And he makes everybody make an image. Where does an image come from? Comes from this side of your brain, where all the imagination, intuition, artistic creativity, all of that, where science fiction stories are written. Right over here. Okay? That's where the image comes from the imagination of man. But listen, according to Scripture, what this false prophet has the ability to do. Revelation 13, 14, he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast, which had the wound by a sword and did live. There's your image. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. I've seen these movies. I've seen the Terminator movies. I've seen The Matrix. I've seen all these others where the robot, the machine world, becomes intelligent, becomes self-aware. They've been given life. They've been given a soul. And now their objective is to make sure that everybody in the world serves them. That's what The Matrix is all about. All of the humans serve the machine world. And if you don't serve the machine world, well, then Agent Smith will come and kill you. That's what this is. That's what this is saying right here. Psalm 135, verse 15. Here is the way that idols and images are right now. This is the way my computer is right now. I have on my tablet, I have right here, there's a little bitty eyeball right here on the side here. It's a camera. And somewhere on here, I could never find it. There's a microphone that picks up the sound of my voice. I think it is down there. Anyway, there's a microphone that picks up the sound of my voice. It's got an ear, and it's got an eye, but it can't really hear, and it can't really see anything and discern what it's seeing. It can't do that. Psalm 135 describes the state of images up until, let's say, tomorrow at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Who knows when the singularity is going to come about, but it's going to. Psalm 135, verse 15. The idols of the heathen are silver and gold, which, by the way, are magnificent electronic conductors. If gold wasn't so expensive, all of your electronic things would be made out of gold, because it's a very good conductor of electricity. Anyway, the idols of the heathen are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. Think of what artificial intelligence is, robotics. It's the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Neither is there any breath in their mouths. Think of the breath. Think of the soul. They that make them are like unto them, so is every one that trusteth in them. In other words, they're saying they're dead. And so is basically everybody that falls after idols and images. But the false prophet is going to do something that has never been done before. Think of when the image of Dagon fell before the Ark of the Covenant. and he couldn't get back up. So he hit his life alert button, and the priest of Dagon said, "What is it?" He said, "I've fallen and I can't get up." But he didn't say that because he had a mouth, but he couldn't talk. So they had to stand him back up. Next day, fell over again. This time his head and hands and everything, the human parts, came flying off, flying across the room. They had to pick him up again. Man has to do for their God what their God cannot do for themselves. I have to tell this iPad what to do because it cannot do by itself yet. And we're getting used to speaking to these things, aren't we? Apple has Siri. Android has something. I don't remember what it was. Microsoft coming out with Cortana. Supposed to be more natural, as if you're really talking to a personal assistant. We're getting used to talking to them like in Star Trek. Computer, yeah, examine the planet down there. We're getting used to talking to the computers, and we're trying to teach them how to listen to us and do what we say. All that's going to flip around one of these days, because the false prophet is going to give life, a soul, self-consciousness, self-awareness to the image of the beast. And he's going to be able to speak. Not only is he going to be able to speak, but he's going to be self-aware enough to understand that everybody must worship him. And if they don't, they have to be killed. That's where we're going. Is the singularity, does singularity have anything to do with that? Listen to, I'm going to read you some articles. I want you to listen to how these technology experts are describing the advancements in technology, the God-like advancements in technology. Here's an article, it's more of an editorial, "The Road to Singularity. Potential Annihilation, Utopian Visions. Will liberty prevail?" It says in 1945, George Orwell, famous for a stunningly accurate portrayal of a future police state in 1984, commented on prominent author C.S. Lewis' book, That Hideous Strength. I've read that book, by the way. It talks about digging Merlin up from the grave. Hideous Strength revolves around the National Institute for Coordinated Experts, NICE, and the organization's plot to seize control of all life. Orwell's commentary was published in the Manchester Evening News in 1945 with the headline, "The Scientists Take Over." From another place in this article, science from all over the world are warning that robots and artificial intelligence could eliminate humanity. Elon Musk, CEO of SpaceX, a private space exploration company, told CNBC recently that he is worried about a, quote, Terminator-like scenario as a result of advancing AI technology. Top AI research, AI means artificial intelligence. Just thought I'd throw that in there. And by the way, let me stop right here. SpaceX, they're the company that built the Dragon. They built the Dragon, the flying Dragon, that takes people up into outer space. It's all part of the same, you're understanding the spirit now behind this. Top AI researcher Hugo de Garis provides another example. DeGaris explains that the development of superintelligent AI may lead to a devastating artelect war that could kill billions of people. This war could break out when two distinct groups of humanity emerge. Listen to this. One group embraces the God-like artificial intelligence and technological advancement with religious fervor. The other group fights to prevent it from being built. He adds that he is more than willing to take the risk, saying, "As a brain builder myself, am I prepared to risk the extinction of the human species for the sake of building an artelect?" Yep. This mindset, common among scientist elites, was articulated by Arthur Croker, professor of political science at the University of Victoria and director of the Pacific Center for Technology and Culture. Croker identified these individuals as suicidal nihilists who can very happily ally themselves with a notion of nuclear holocaust or perfect exterminism. They're creating again and again the exterminism of human memory, the exterminism of human sensibility, the exterminism of individual human intelligence. Then, watch this. Mark Andreessen is a Silicon Valley tycoon who has founded several multi-billion dollar tech companies, including Mosaic, the first widely used web browser, I remember that, and Netscape. He recently drew criticism from Salon magazine for a tweet storm on Twitter that praised the godlike power of advanced technology. Salon ran the headline, "The tech industry's God complex is getting out of control." Now watch this next paragraph. Andreessen tweeted, "I am firmly convinced many people are fundamentally underestimating the power and potential of these new superpowers in the years ahead," he continued. "Combined modern bio, 3D printing, and computing, prosthetics and exoskeletons, superpower, paralyzed to walk, disabled to abled, blind to see." Does this sound like a messiah in there to you? These people are writing and telling us that there's going to be two groups one of these days, two types of people, those who are and those who aren't. Those who have embraced the technology and melded the technology into their own biosystems, their body, to give them advancements, enhancements, God-like powers. And then the puny humans who don't have that. And there's going to be a war. There's going to be a war. Revelation 19, go read it. But it's against the beast, the false prophet, and all the people, e pluribus, gathered as one there in the valley of Armageddon. The beast, the false prophet, is going to have total control over everybody on the planet who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Total control. How? Artificial intelligence. The mixing of technology with human beings. But we have to build the God first. We have to build it. And we're working on it right now. Here's another article. Robotic helpers. Scientists tout cheap robot that assembles itself. Scientists say they have developed a low-cost robot prototype made from paper and children's trinkets that can assemble itself and perform a task without human help. Remember, the idea is right now, the humans had to help Dagon stand back up. And after Dagon, or you could say Humpty Dumpty, all of his pieces fell apart, the humans had to help piece him all back together. But now we're teaching the robots that they don't need us to help them. We're teaching them, just like we teach children, we're teaching them to help themselves. That if they break or they fall, pieces come off, let's put new pieces on. Let's teach you, the robot, how to fix yourself. Nothing irritates a PC user more than Windows locking up, the blue screen of death. Ah! Nothing irritates Windows users more than for their something to happen to their computer and it doesn't work right anymore. And we either have to fix it ourselves, we have to pay some guy an exorbitant amount of money to do something very simple like just to turn it off and turn it back on again, it'll be fine. You really, that's all I had to do and I'm paying you $100? Well, yeah, you know, but hey, you know. There's some people who's, you know, they got these big desktop computers. They complain because their coffee cup holder broke. The CD tray. Some of you will figure that out later. So we're teaching the robots to fix themselves so that they can be smart enough to do for themselves so they don't need us anymore. Catch it. They're becoming like a god. Here's another one. The evolution of the humanoid robot. The age of computers, things evolve exponentially. That's what Ray Kurzweil was saying. In just a few generations, robots have gone from a scientific fantasy to a playful curiosity to entering the battlefield to replace and or augment their human counterparts. We are already at the point where we have to consider what the next step of robotic evolution looks like. According to robotics engineers, It appears that at some point in the near future, the next step could very well be whatever the next generation robot chooses for itself. The humanoid robot is now poised to take a leap from a mere facsimile of human behavior to one that futurists suggest will not only walk like a human, but will possess self-awareness as well as a full range of high-tech computational spectrum analysis and capabilities and emotions. Now, let me stop right here. Not only are we building these robots, not only are we building them to be smarter and smarter and smarter, to think like humans. Here's the problem. Me, human being, I cannot hear, nor do I know right now, everybody that lives on the planet. How could I? I don't have a chance to meet everybody. And even if I do, if you come to Bethel and visit us, and we treat you well and give you some DVDs and just everything like that, you come here and visit, you come here 6 months later, I'll look at you and go, have you ever been here before? Because I don't kind of remember you. That's just me. Don't be offended at that, all right? It's because I'm not a robot. I'm not a computer. What is it that we know for a fact that we're doing right now in this age of technology? We know for a fact that just about every place we walk in town, just about every phone call we make, every conversation we have, everything we like on the internet, every picture we put up, every video we make, every email, text message, you name it, everything about us that when we have an interaction with our digital counterpart, all of that is recorded and stored somewhere. They're databasing all of our digital footprints, every one of them. So now a computer who we are teaching to think like us, which is not good, we're teaching them to think like us, will have an advantage over us in that this computer, this robot, this artificial intelligence system will be able to access the database of everybody on the planet and know them, know how they think, know how they walk, know what they do, know what they are going to do. This artificial intelligence system is going to be like a god over mankind, because right now God knows everybody and he doesn't need random access memory to do it. God just knows everybody and everything. So when this artificial intelligence system evolves to that point, it will have, I would say, nearly unlimited knowledge, but it will be limited. We know that. It will have a nearly unlimited knowledge of everybody on the planet who has a digital footprint. It'll know you. It'll know where you're going to, it'll know what you want for lunch. It will. Think of, go watch 2001 A Space Odyssey. Weird movie. But the HAL 9000 computer on board that spaceship controlled those humans. Controlled them, killed them, took over that ship. Now the article goes on. Here we go. This is where it gets interesting. Now enter DARPA. DARPA stands for the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, defense. You know what that is? The Pentagon, the Defense Department, has a special part of it, an agency that does advanced research projects. And it has a lot of money to spend. And it funds private contracted experiments in artificial intelligence because it realizes that maybe the smartest people on the planet didn't join the military. So they go after these guys who are really smart. They give them a ton of money, let them do whatever they want to, and when they figure stuff out, the military gets it. See how it works? By the way, the internet. You're probably watching this on the internet right now. The first internet in the world was called the ARPANET, Advanced Research Projects Agency, from the Defense Department. The Defense Department wanted a way of linking all of its computers together in the case of a some say nuclear war, so that the information on one computer, if it was blown up, wouldn't be lost. It would be shared throughout the ARPANET. That was really the first internet. That was back when Al Gore was inventing it for him. Anyway, God complex indeed. Enter DARPA, which had already been working on its projects, but through its robotics grand challenge, has spurred a huge influx of inventors looking to receive DARPA funding to offer the next generation of humanoids. The challenge has been couched in the comforting language of disaster response research, but what is emerging seems to be capable of far more than that. The primary goal of DARPA Robotics Challenge Program is to develop ground robotic capabilities to execute, to execute complex tasks in dangerous, degraded, human-engineered environments. The program will focus on robots that can utilize available human tools, ranging from hand tools to vehicles. The program aims to advance the key robotic technologies of supervised autonomy, mounted mobility, dismounted mobility, dexterity strength, and platform endurance. Supervised autonomy will be developed to allow robot control by non-expert operators to lower operator workload, and to allow effective operation despite low fidelity, such as low bandwidth, high latency. And these are all communications terms, and I kind of understand them a little bit. But here's what they're doing. They're wanting these scientists and these geeks to go out and build them a Terminator. That's what they're wanting. Go back to the 1980s. Remember the 1980s? High top tennis shoes. Love the 80s. 1980s. James Cameron, young and upcoming Hollywood film director, conceives this idea called the Terminator. That in, there was a time when the computer world, built by the military, was going to be so far advanced that they would be self-aware, they would start a war on planet Earth, and the robots and the AIs and the computers would take over that were built by the military. That was in the 80s. We were barely using, I was still using a Commodore 64 computer, 64 kilobytes of random access memory. The computer that we do our rendering on, video rendering, is 8 gigabytes. You go from kilo to milla to giga. That's how far we've gone. How is it that James Cameron imagined a scenario whereby the military was going to produce the killer robots? We'll get into that a little bit later on, okay? When we start talking about movies and the imaginations and science fiction and creativity, we're going to talk about that, because that's what is spurring all of this along. Whatever man dreams up, that's what he's going to have the ability to do. So we're finding out that all of these AI companies, all of these startups, all of these geeks who go on robot wars, remember those? All of these people designing these artificial intelligence systems, there is a God complex about it. They're not going, this, all of the scientists all over the world are not going to get to the point to where we push this button and all of the artificial intelligence systems will become self-aware the moment we push this button. Well, we better not push that button. Yeah, I agree. We probably shouldn't push that button because we don't know what's going to happen. Are you kidding me? You know what scientists do? They push buttons not knowing what's going to happen. Because why? Because they want to see what happens. They're going to push the button. Godlike complex indeed. Here's what I found very interesting about this whole artificial intelligence system, all the advancements in robotics. These people absolutely have a God complex. You know how I know? They're naming all of their robots and artificial intelligence systems after gods. Check this one out. Watch MIT's Atlas robot carry heavy objects. They named it after a god who allegedly holds up the earth. Atlas doesn't exist. God does. In fact, God doesn't even hold up the earth. He doesn't need to, because the Bible says he hung it upon nothing. It's just hanging there. The earth is just hanging there and spinning because God said so. That's why. It doesn't need Atlas to hold it up. But they named their robot, the robot that has the ability to pick up very, very heavy, large objects, they named it after a god who picks up and holds very, very, very large objects. I'm not done. Here is a group called the Genie Lab. And you're probably thinking Robin Williams, Aladdin. That's probably what you're thinking, okay? Or some of you are not. But you are looking at this very peculiar symbol that they use. Very interesting. Genie Lab. Let me read to you a little bit about Genie Lab. The Genie Lab, newly launching in 2013, builds heavily on the prior work of its founders in their pursuit to realize genius. Stop right here. Where do you find out what the word genius really means? I didn't know this until I started looking at this. Well, yeah, genius, that's somebody that's got, you know, a lot of smarts. They're a genius. Albert Einstein. He was a genius. They only named people geniuses who have high intelligence because of what the word genius really means. Just wait. It's coming up, all right? Genius machines. Robots with greater than human consciousness, creativity, and compassion. Now, you could say, oh, yeah, compassion's good. It has compassion. Calm means with. Passion means emotions. With greater than human emotions. Greater than humans. God-like compassions. To achieve this goal, we named the Genie Lab as a nonprofit working group to advance the science and engineering super intelligent walking robots. Now, take a look at this. When we think of a genie, this is normally what we think of. We think of phenomenal cosmic power in a teeny tiny space. Okay? See, Robin Williams and Aladdin? Yeah. Okay? Anyway, that's what we think of. A genie is, according to Islamic thought, Middle Eastern thought, the idea of a genie goes back even before Islam. But in the Quran, genies are mentioned quite prevalent. They are spirits. They can either be benevolent or malevolent, which means good or bad. And the Quran teaches that these jinns, these genies or jinn, they call them, were made by God. As man was made out of dirt, they believe that the jinns were made out of fire, which is really, really interesting in light of Psalm 104, which says, "Who maketh his angel spirits, his ministers, a flaming fire." And so in this little area here, the Muslims, the Islamic believers, the Middle Eastern people, and again, this mythology goes all the way back even before Islam, but the Prophet Muhammad believed it, was that these jinn were spirits made out of fire. And that's exactly what the Bible says about angels. He maketh his angel spirits, his ministers, a flaming fire. Remember the cherub that sat at the entrance to the Garden of Eden holding a flaming sword. And when it says his ministers, there are good angels. We know Michael is one. We know Gabriel is one. But there are also evil angels as well. And they are made out of what the Bible refers to as fire. So what are we dealing with? When we're dealing with the jinn or genies, we're dealing with spirits, familiar spirits, gods, little g. That's what we're dealing with. And go back to this article here. The Genie Lab is all about building genius machines, robots with greater than human consciousness, more than us. We are building a God. That's what we're doing, people. Now, but then, I found out. See, when they, what was it, the Arabian Nights? When that book was translated from Arabic, I think into French or whatever, the translator, when it saw the word jinn, referring to these gods, these devils that were made out of fire, he used the Latin word that looked like it and sounded like it. And really, there is a connection here. He used the word genius. What does the word genius mean? It's from Wikipedia. In ancient Roman religion, I didn't know this until a few days ago. In ancient Roman religion, the genius was the individual instance of a general divine nature that is present in every individual person, place, or thing. In other words, it's like pantheism or panentheism, where a God is in everything or every creature and everybody. And so if, let's say that I'm working on something in the kitchen, I'm cooking something, and all of a sudden just this bash of creativity comes on me, and I start mixing ingredients, and I get it on the stove, and I cook it, and I serve it up to the table, and my wife and kids are eating this, and they're going, "This is absolutely amazing. I've never had anything this good." That story's never happened, by the way, but they're doing this. It would be like a spark of genius in me that came up with all, what's in here? I don't know. I just started putting it together. It's just like it just seemed the right thing to do. We would say you just have this spark of genius in him. Well, the concept comes from ancient Rome that says that basically there's a God over everything. Here's some examples. The genius of love, the genius of victory, genius of Palermo, the genius of liberty. Think of what's on top of the Capitol building, the United States of America. It's a 19.5-foot statue called Liberty. It's a genius of liberty, a god or a goddess of liberty. We're dealing with spirits. Look here. Genius of Alexander, the genius of war, god of war. Genius of the resistance, the genius of Beethoven. The genius of peace of Paris, the genius of America. It's the idea that there is a god, a super intelligent God that takes over at times and leads a cause, or it does this, or it makes the crops grow, whatever. Basically, pantheism and panentheism is what it is. So they name it the Genie Lab, and it's basically saying we're building a God. Now, take a look at this. Geniuses are, these little gods are related to what we call daemons, or what has been called daemons. Now, some of you say, well, that's like demons. That's what's in the Bible. The King James Bible never uses the word demon. It's not in here. It actually uses the word devil, and here's why, I think. The word devil is spelled like and sounds like the word evil. Devil and evil. Why? Because all devils are evil. The devil is evil. They're never good. So the King James never uses the word daemons. He uses the word devil and uses that to describe spirits, ministers of fire, flaming fire spirits like jinn and geniuses, gods, uses that to describe them because they are in fact evil. They're not good. And the Bible uses, take a look at this picture. Familiar spirits come in various beast forms, a wolf or an owl. For more information on that, we did a video called Mystery Creatures of the Bible and Where Dragons Live. And I show you from the Bible the spiritual side of what owls, satyrs, and wolves, and dragons, and serpents, and unicorns, what they all really represent in the spiritual world. Owls and wolves are rulers of the darkness of this world. and their spiritual equivalents in the spiritual realm are devils. But here's a webpage called Your Daemons, Give Me Your Soul. And it's, you go to this webpage and it's all of these people talking about their animal spirit guides that they refer to as daemons. Daemon and geniuses are related in that they are non-biological intelligent entities, intelligent creatures. Think of, I'm here at Ezekiel 28. God said of the prince of Tyrus, when he says, I'm going to sit in the seat of God, behold, thou art wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that they can hide from thee. And I submit to you that the devil, though he be a beast in the spiritual realm, is a very intelligent, wise beast. What do we say of owls? He's the wise old owl. The owl is a symbol for wisdom, but it's a symbol of the occult because they rule over the darkness. Owls in the Bible, go study owls in the Bible. Go study satyrs. Go study unicorns. Go study dragons and serpents and wolves. You'll find out that they represent devils, or that is the image of them. They are devils. These people refer to them as daemons, simply meaning these are spirits that help us and rule with us. When you get into witchcraft, even at the youngest age, I've looked at books that are encouraging young girls to get into witchcraft. They tell them to find your animal familiar spirit, to find some animal that you can link to that the gods have sent over to you that you're going to relate to. That's going to be your familiar. That's going to be your animal spirit guide. In the First Nations or Native American cultures, that's what they, you go in the sweat lodge, you're going to find the beast that you're going to hook into for the rest of your life. That beast is going to guide you. He's, oh, the great wolf or the great eagle or the great sparrow or whatever it is. That's what you're going to do. They're referring to these gods as super intelligent entities or daemons. The Bible's calling them devils. Now, what's the connection here? I'm a geek in that computers have always fascinated me. I'm self-taught as concerning what I know about how to operate things in Windows. My mom calls me, can you fix my computer? Yeah, I'll come right over and I'll do a couple things. How did you know all that? Well, Mom, you know, I've been doing this all my life. So I'm kind of self-taught. Taught myself a little bit about networking, hooking two computers together. I know about when two... Here's something interesting. Let's bring... I'm just kind of talking a little bit here. Let's bring Fat Albert Pike into this. One of the things that I know, that I remembered early on, about when they started wanting computers to talk to one another in a network, they wanted them to get along and share a common bond between them, share information between them. So these computer geeks back in the 60s and 70s, they developed these protocols. They gave them different names. And I know that, I don't know if it's still done this way, but I know that back then, whenever two computers linked together, they each sent a packet of information to one another that was referred to as a handshake. And the handshake had to be exactly right or the computers wouldn't talk to one another. This computer would send out a packet of information with his hand like this, okay? And then this computer would stick his hand out like this and they would do a grip of the lion's paw like masons do. See, if you go up to a mason, you just give them a regular handshake, they know you're not a mason. You go up to a mason, somebody you think is a mason, give them the grip of a lion paw and see what you get back. You get another grip of the lion paw. You know what? You guys have decided that you're both masons and you don't need to talk. Are you a mason? Well, are you a mason? Well, yeah, I am a mason. No, they learned that by the handshake. And that's initially what got computers talking to one another. Packet of bits and bytes here that looked like this, that matched this packet of bits and bytes, and they shook hands. Now that we're going to talk to one another. I think there's a spirit involved in a lot of this. Probably most of it. I'll show you that as we move along. This is where we're going to here. because this little piece of information that I remember seeing back years ago, I've experimented with Windows. I go all the way back to the days of DOS. I really liked DOS, disk operating system, my MS-DOS and so on. Every now and then, I'll pull a computer out that has Linux on it. This is where I first learned it, because I didn't see it really in any of the Windows systems. I go all the way back to Windows 3.1, Windows 95, 98, Windows ME, XP, Vista, Windows 7, Windows 8. And you don't really see them in Windows systems, but they're there. They're just called something different. I think Terminate and Stay Resident programs. But I found this out learning or trying to teach myself a little bit about the Linux operating system. Your DVR at home possibly is a Linux system. There are Linux systems all over the place. I don't want to go into the whole history of it, but it's based upon Unix. Unix was really one of the first big operating systems between these big mainframe computers. Linux is a version of it. Mac OS is a Unix-based system. They actually have little bits of programs built into the operating system called daemons. Not making that up. And there's a reason why they were called that. I asked the question. I wanted to learn more about it. So I thought, do I know an expert on computers who's written software before? Her name is Donna. She has written our King James Pure Bible Search software, done an outstanding job on it. And did it very quickly. So I asked her about daemons. I said, Donna, I know a little bit, but in the simplest terms you can muster, send me some information about programs that are called daemons, devils. And here's what she said. One big one is that Apple actually runs BSD, which is Linux's cousin, on the Mac. BSD's logo mascot comes from their daemon. If you type in, go to Google and type in BSD mascot, you're going to get a picture of a devil with a trident, all right? Its name is Beastie, play on the letters BSD, Beastie, which can be pronounced Beastie, okay? Their mascot is called Hexley, the number 6. Not making this up. And the kernel type is known as a hybrid, a fusion between microkernel and monolithic kernel. Don't quite understand that one, but I think I could probably learn. The term daemon is actually more akin to familiar spirits and eudaimonia than with what the world knows as demonic forces. But as you know, there really isn't much difference. It's just the world doesn't realize that familiar spirits are satanic demons. Well, now they know, Donna, because I'm telling everybody that that's what these daemons are. That's what the geniuses are. They are familiar spirits. So they're building, the Genie Lab is building a God-like, spiritual, intelligent being that's going to rule over people. Because that's what these animal guides do. They rule over these people. Beast ruling over man instead of man ruling over beast. And it's all done voluntarily. These people asked these familiar spirits to rule over them. And so are we. In computers, the main process forks a background process, hence the reason for the trident and the daemon mascot that behaves as a familiar spirit, taking care of necessary processes that other process can go to and consult with. Here's how you find this out. On your Windows machine, I don't know how to do it anywhere else, on your Windows machine, hit Control Alt Delete at the same time. Press Control down, hold it, Alt down, and Delete. You're going to get a screen that's going to have a bunch of stuff on it. On the bottom, it's going to say Task Manager. Click that. It's going to show you on one tab all the programs that are running on the forefront of your computer. If you go over one tab where it says Processes, click that. My mom goes, how did you learn all of this? Mom, I just figured it out. Hit Processes. You're going to find that you thought you were running 3 programs at one time on your computer. You weren't. You were running 30. 35, 40 in some cases, depending on how many screensavers you downloaded, how many viruses and Trojans you have on your computer. Quit downloading screensavers from the internet. Good grief. Anyway, and all these free games that you can download, there's a catch. You download the free games, they're going to take over your computer. Just telling you. You know what they do? They put all of these background processes going on. These are programs. Daemons are programs that are always going on in the background. They're always there. You don't see them on the screen. You don't see them in the light of the screen. You don't see them on the desktop. You have to kind of peel off a few layers of your operating system to find out that they're there. But they're there. And they've been running the whole time. Some of them, like I say, you downloaded a card game from the internet. Well, it was free. You installed it. You gave it permission to do what it's doing. You installed it. And now all of a sudden, when you pull Firefox up or Internet Explorer or Chrome, you pull it up and you type in something you're going to search for in the internet, all of a sudden now your search engine's different. And it's giving you different results. Do you know why? You know why? Because these daemons in the background are not letting you do what you thought you wanted to do. You gave them permission to take you to some other search engine to give you different results. Why? Because these websites are controlled this daemon that runs in the background, and these websites get a lot of money from advertisers and junk where they want you to go to their website and look at their stuff as opposed to anything else you wanted to. And you gave them permission to do it. A lot of these daemons that run on most people's computers are there, and most people, well, my computer's running slow, and I don't know why. It's probably because you got 50 daemons in your computer all running and all trying to divert your attention to where they were programmed to send you on the internet. That's just one of the things that these things do. But anyway, listen to this. This is what Donna said. The name daemon, originally came from Maxwell's daemon, who was the imaginary being in a famous thought experiment believed to be constantly sorting molecules in the background. Fernando Corbato was the first to term the word daemon for computers in his work on Project Mac, M-A-C. MAC originally stood for mathematics and computation, but later was said to stand for man and computer and machine-aided cognitions. Cognition, when you're cognitive, that means you're awake, you're alert, and you're aware of surroundings. It was part of the MIT Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory funded by DARPA, Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. Some of the daemons running on my Linux machine include httpd. On a Linux machine, you can always find, here's what I know, the daemon program, because it ends with the letter D. Running the web server, DHCP, handling dynamic IP assignments. So when I kind of understand a little bit of this, they each behave much like a familiar spirit, which other parts of the computer consult with. That's where it came from, people. Daemons, in fact, here's a picture of Linux and Beastie with his trident, his forks, and sort of a diagram of how all of these daemons work in the background. Basically, they are programs, intelligent programs, that are running behind the scenes that other parts of your upfront programs are consulting with and getting information from and being told what to do with itself. The whole evolutionary process of the computer development, software development, operating system development. Operating system is what happens when your computer first turns on. If it's a Mac, it's going to load Macintosh. Leopard. Think about it. Lions. Okay? The beast. If it's Windows, it's going to load up Windows. If Linux, it's going to open up Linux. Unix or whatever it is. There's a bunch of other X's out there. But that's the operating system. It tells the computer what to do with itself. In the whole evolution of computers, computer science, operating system programming, and software development, the whole concept has been given over to mankind by way of familiar spirits, because the computers operate exactly like the Witch of Endor consulting with a hidden god about what, you know, she was a witch, she consulted with familiar spirits. That is exactly the way that most of the software on computers runs and works. When we say that the artificial intelligence systems, we are building gods, it is exactly, it fits exactly with the model given to us in the scriptures. So now with this knowledge in mind, let's go back to the scriptures to see something I think is relevant. Exodus chapter 32. Remember what happened there? Moses is up on Mount Sinai. This is like a picture of the first and second coming of Christ. Moses is up on Mount Sinai. He's heard from God. He's up there getting God's law. What are the Israelites doing? Exodus 32, verse 1. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, up, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him. Jeremiah 16:20, shall a man make gods unto himself, and they are no gods? Let's stop right here for a minute. Let's look at what Israel wanted Aaron to do. They said, get up, make us gods. That is exactly what humanity is crying unto all of those who are feverishly working on programming, technology, circuit boards, artificial intelligence, robotic systems. They are demanding with their dollars, make us gods. Make my computer faster, make it smarter, make it intuitive. You know what that means? That means the computer is able to figure out what we want without us even asking. You get out of the car, you start walking up the sidewalk, the front door unlocks for you and opens because it recognizes who you are. Hello, Mr. Johnson. I've prepared your favorite dish for this evening. Would you like a newspaper? I have it laid out on the table for you. That's what your smart home is going to have the ability to do one of these days. Make us gods. We want gods. And then it says, which shall go before us. You know what that means? Moses was the one who went before Israel and led them out of Egypt. They wanted to go back to Egypt, but they wanted a god to lead them there. See what we're doing? We're building gods. They're going to lead us back into bondage. Just like the Bible said, shall a man make gods unto himself? We're making the gods. In fact, that's what gods are. Gods are always man-made. Acts chapter 19, verse 26. You remember the controversy that Paul got into? Paul was going around preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the craftsmen, where do you find out what the connection is with them? The craftsmen, the guys who made gods, they were ticked off at Paul. You know why? Look at what it said, Acts 19:26. Moreover, you see and hear that not alone at Ephesus, but almost throughout all Asia, this Paul hath persuaded and turned away much people, saying that they be no gods which are made with hands. That's what I'm telling you. That's what Paul is telling you. It's what the gospel is telling you. Our gods are not what we make with our hands. Whether it's some dumb idol that you pray to, or a super intelligent, daemon-infested machine, genie, a genius, that leads us back into bondage. These are not gods. These are not the gods we want. made with men's hands. The God that we want made us with his hands, breathed into us the breath of life. So here's what we're learning. Thanks to Donna. I saw first time I started fooling with Linux, I'm going, really? You have these programs running in the background, you call them demons? Some just don't sound right about that. Well, I was right, because that's exactly what's going on. So here we have these daemons that are hidden processes. And again, you don't see them up on the screen. You'll never see them up on the screen. But the things, the programs that are running on the screen are always consulting with the daemons, the devils, the gods. They're always in darkness. Think about it. Think of it that way. So now we look at the scriptures. Job 34, 21. For his eyes are upon the ways of man, and he seeth all his goings. There's no darkness nor shadow of death where the workers of iniquity may hide themselves. Psalm 91, 6. Nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness. Joel chapter 2, think of what the day of the Lord is. It's a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness as the morning spread upon the mountains. Stop right here. The day of the Lord is a day of thick darkness. It's where the demons are. And clouds. When I worked on this presentation, I worked on it at a main computer. I then had to transfer it to my secondary computer, my iPad. You know how I did it? I stored it in the cloud. That's what it's called. We're gonna talk about cloud computing. I don't know when, but we're going to. Because to me, it's very interesting. And think of the whole point of the internet, the web, and everything that we're doing right now. Every industry in the world knows this, that we're migrating from locally controlled computing to cloud computing. In other words, we're going to be using not our software and our super fast computers. We're going to be using Google Docs right now. Some of you are linked in already with Google Documents. You have word processing, spreadsheet, and presentations. Evernote. I use Evernote. It's a cloud service. I put all these articles you send me, emails and stuff like that, I put them in the Evernote. And you know what? When I get ready to do some research, I just search in the cloud. Evernote now has the ability to do slide presentations. So everything that's being done now and in the future is going to be done where? Shrouded in the cloud. You have no idea what's going on back there, do you? That's somebody else's computer that you don't have any control over. Think about it. The day of the Lord is gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains. What does that thick darkness produce? A great people and a strong. There hath not ever been the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. So what are we looking at? We're looking at systems that we have built in this world, starting all the way back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, the home and computer explosion in the 80s and the 90s. Now we're in the tablet and mobile device revolution. But we can already see, 2014, we can already see that we're all well on our way to advancing beyond mobile computing. We're going to migrate one of these days into the transfusion of the computer devices from here to here. And remember, all of this computer technology, all of the software, all of the things, even on my iPad, I'm looking at a display of my PowerPoint, and I think this is all that's running on my iPad. There's daemons working behind the scenes that this program is communicating with in darkness that I don't know about. That was designed precisely the way This world is designed where people are being consulted by familiar spirits. Next week, we're going to look at a concept that's related to this. It's called the ghost in the machine. Where do you find out just how much technology has been inspired by familiar spirits? I sat up 11 o'clock. I was ready to go to bed, and a thought came. Mike, just think about how Francis Crick said that he discovered how DNA was a double twisted helix. I've talked about it before. We're going to go there next week. We're going to look at the ghost in the machine. It's part of the singularity. This is where we're headed. Think about it, all right? Hey, God bless you. This is Pastor Mike. We will see you next time. Bye-bye.